Good evening, folks. Like you haven't heard enough from me yet, but I want to talk to you about 10-year anniversary, SEVillage, right? It's kind of crazy. So when my team and I were sitting around talking about like what I should flap my lips about, we said maybe there's some lessons that we've learned over the last decade of putting on this village here at DEF CON that we can apply to the community, to ourselves, to figure out what it is that we can learn. So every year, I always start off asking like, how many people is first time DEF CON. Always shocks me. Literally this year, I think it was over 60% of the hands went up. And then I ask how many people first time SEVillage, both morning, afternoon, the days, and I see an overwhelming amount of hands. So I thought because of that, the best way to start this off is kind of to tell you the origin story. Let me make sure this thing is on, of SEVillage, right? So I figured let's have a story time, a little bit about, before we get to the lessons learned, about how all of this started. So here's the path that we took. DEF CON 17, I came to DEF CON 17 and got asked to sit on a judging panel for a social engineering contest that was happening here. It was right after my first book had come out. And that contest was a little weird. It did not follow our mantra of leaving people feeling better for having met them. They were calling random college girls and getting their credit card numbers and not muting those numbers while they were being read. And I was horrified. I was sitting there going, oh, no, I cannot be a part of this. I get paid to do this by really big companies, and this is not a great thing to have on video. And you can see people in the audience writing down these numbers, and I'm thinking, oh, no, this is bad. So I had a little conversation with some people at DEF CON and talked about, you know, hey, maybe we should professionalize this. You know, gave them some tips, and Jeff said, good, do it. And I'm like, no, I was just telling you what you should do. I wasn't saying I wanted to do it. I was just saying, like, here's the things you should do. And he's like, great, we'll see you next year with your competition. And I'm like, but wait. And then I'm like, I just got social engineered by Jeff Moss. You're like, come on, he isn't social engineer people, really? What the heck? So I'm like, okay, now I gotta go home and think about all this. So all my ideas scared the daylights out of everyone I told them to. So I did the natural thing, and I had, at the time, I was new in my company. It was, you know, we were just starting off. I was still working in another job, and I said, I don't have a lot of money, so I called the EFF. And I said, hey, I got this idea. I want to throw it by you. They assigned a couple lawyers to me. We went through it, and we went through all the things that I could and could not do. And they were so amazing. I'm telling you, if you don't support the EFF, you should, because they helped me like for months and months and months and months for nothing, just to make sure that we can get this competition off the ground and not break any laws. Then I did a whole mess of interviews. So I went on podcasts and magazines to try to promote this. And that I thought was a great idea. But one of the themes of the speech will be my thinking of great ideas generally might not always be great ideas, because what ended up happening is some big companies that rhyme with like Apple and Microsoft and other ones like Oracle all went and complained that they were going to be hacked live by malicious evil hackers at DEF CON. So I got a phone call. And if anyone knows the history between me and Dave Kennedy, this story will make sense to you. I learned a valuable lesson that day, that Dave Kennedy is not the FBI. So I get a call from a guy who says, hey, this is so-and-so from the FBI. And I'm like, nice try, Dave. I've already fallen for this prank a number of times and hung up on him. So if you don't know who Dave is, Dave runs Trusted Sec and Derby Con, and he's made a career, lifelong career of pranking me. Like at one point, he actually modified the heater in his seat of his car, the passenger side, so you can boil water on it, and then invited me out to dinner. Yeah, that, I'm telling you, that's what stuff he does. Like, this is the kind of pranks he plays on me. Other ones are not made for this village at a PG-13 level, so I will not tell you them. But you can imagine that that kind of response from him, like this would make sense to me. So the guy calls back, and I'm like, Dave, seriously, man, give it up. I'm not going to fall for it. And he's like, sir, please don't hang up on me. You know, we really have to have this. And I'm like, this doesn't sound like Dave. And I'm like, so you're not Dave Kennedy? He's like, no, I already told you my name and you should not hang up again. I'm like, fun times. So I get invited down to Virginia to present the SECTF idea. And fortunately, I'm still here. So I didn't end up in prison. That was great. So we did our very, very first SECTF at DEF CON 18. But the things I had to present to people to just make sure that they knew that we weren't these evil malicious hackers that were going to go and wreck the earth was basically this set of rules, right? So our contest was really designed, and you've heard it if you've been in the room at all. We designed our contest with the mantra of leave them feeling better for having met you. We wanted to show how dangerous social engineering is as a vector, especially through vishing, and to see if over the years, and we did not plan on doing it for 10, but to see if over the years we can show that there would be some improvement or not, despite all the people and the wonderful people working in this competition. So we split it into two, which was first OSINT portion of the competition, and then second was the call portion of the competition. And we figured that would give us a lot of data that we can analyze. What are we finding on social media and on the internet? And what are we finding through live calls? So we launched the competition with one main rule, and that is that no one gets victimized. Not the people in the booth, not the people we're calling. Okay, so DEF CON 18 kicks off, and that was the title of it, the How Strong Is Your Schmooze? You can see our art has changed over the years a little bit. That's a little... Yeah, okay, anyhow, let's move on. That was our room. It was 175 square feet. Anyone here there for that first one? Yeah. Really? Whoa, holy mackerel, there's more hands than I expected. Holy mackerel, wow, yeah. Round of applause to you. So I also laud you because you're still here and you're not dead because that was in the RIV. And so many of you sat on the floor. See, that was, I don't know, back in the day, like maybe DEF CON didn't care so much about what the fire marshal said. So we had more humans in that room than we should have ever had. Like, I'm surprised we didn't all combust. It was so hot in that room. My little drum booth, you could see it back there. And we had one speaker that I brought because we couldn't tie into the house speakers because everyone hacked the house and the sound didn't work. So we had one speaker. And we hired someone to stand there and type, like a court stenographer, to type everything that was said. Learned my lesson on that one, too. Anyhow, our very, very first ever competitor for the SECTF ever, Wayne, stand up. Come on, do it. Wayne, right here. And I said, oh, you're from Australia. You can go first. And that was the way we decided things back then. There was absolutely no thing. It was like, oh, yeah, let him go. And I completely nailed it, right? Completely nailed that first call ever 10 years ago. There he is. We're still friends, and he didn't kill me. So we went through that year, and I got to say something, hopefully somewhat humble brag. We were the first and only ever competition in DEF CON history to be awarded a black badge on the first year. And that was something that was we never expected that, right? So when they came in and said, we can't believe what you put together in the room and the pact and how you did it, so black badge, and that was since then. I don't know about every year because it's never guaranteed, right? So we'll see what happens this year, but every year we've been a black badge competition since even the first one, yeah. So then we did DEF CON 19, the schmooze strikes back. Yeah, you know, because we're really genius with those names, you know. And because of the success of the first year, we were upgraded. And the room was huge. It was really, really big. Not this, but I mean compared to the 175 square feet, I thought there's no way we can ever fill this room. And just like what you guys done this year, it was ridiculous. There was lines all the way down the hallway. It was just unbelievable the way that it went off. But again, we had another very, very successful year. But then we started to think, I wonder if the SECTF is enough. Maybe we should do more things. Because, you know, after the calls were over, we would sit around and chat with people about social engineering. We always had handcuffs in there. We'd show people how to break out of them. We'd sit around and pick locks. We'd do fun stuff, but it wasn't structured. So we said, maybe we should start structuring some things. So we did during DEFCON 20, where we decided to up the game and we did Battle of the Sexes, where we pit men against women. So same company, right? So the goal was with this was we had one target company and that we would assign to both a male and a female target and to see who would be better. You could probably guess who won. Yeah. Was it men? Just in case. In case you were confused. Okay. So, yeah, Battle of the Sexes was that. And this, again, that stepped up the competition on 20. Something really interesting happened that year. So that year, General Alexander, the director of the NSA, was at DEFCON. I know that sounds really weird just saying that out loud, right? Like the director, right? So I got called in the middle of we were doing a call, and I learned my lesson, by the way, from previous 3 years ago now, and they said, the director of the NSA is here, he'd like to see you. And I'm like, I'm in the middle of doing a phone call right now, and they're like, please come to this room. And I'm like, okay, if this is Dave, I'm just going to go anyway, because if it's not, I think it's just a safe bet to go. So we paused the whole room, like, no kidding. Can you imagine this? Any of you sat here today? We paused the whole room. I go into this little room, and there's like Secret Service everywhere. And me being me, I like walk right through them up to him and go to shake his hand. And this like giant dude tackles me. And I'm like, yo, you invited me here. Everyone chill, right? So, you know, we end up talking for a few minutes. And he says, we've been watching what you have been doing. And I'm like, of course you have. Of course you have. I mean, come on. We all knew that already, right? And he says, is it okay if I come into your room and observe the competition? I'm like, yeah, sure. So at that point, when he walked in the room, actually, that didn't happen first. We had 7 Secret Service agents come through the room and sweep it. And then they said he's allowed in. And in the booth was our youngest ever competitor. Hannah, are you here? There she is, everyone. Still our friend. And he got to observe the call. And then he came up front. And what's happening here is I feel really honored by this. He awarded me a director's coin for the director of the NSA, which I still have on my wall, which I guess they're really special. I don't know much about that, so excuse my ignorance. But I guess there's like 4 of them get given out a year. So I felt that a big honor. And he said, son, and not in that voice, but I'm going to try anyway. Son, what you're doing is great for our country. Keep doing it. And after that, it was like, no more newspaper articles about us being scary hackers. Everything was like, the glorious hackers are saving the United States from bad social engineers. And I'm like, thank you, Mr. Alexander. General Alexander, sir, don't tase me, bro. And something else really amazing happened at that speech. So we had one guy in the booth, and he decided to do this crazy thing. He said, his target, let's just say it rhymes with AT&T, and he went through their page, and on their security engineer's page, they put the pictures of all of their employees. So he said, I'm going to pick one that looks like me. Maybe if he looks like me, he'll sound like me. I know the logic isn't good, right? It's really not sound. There's actually no scientific evidence that that's true, but he said, let me do the thing. So he did, and he picked this guy, and he starts pretexting as him. And he's calling, and his pretext, which is utterly ridiculous, is, hey, there's this big hacker convention going on called DEFCON. I think we're a target. I want to make sure your machines are secure. What OS are you on? And people were just like, flag, 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 flag. And I'm like, this can't work. This doesn't make sense. I don't like what's happening here. Well, finally, he gets somebody on the phone, and he says, the guy turns him down and hangs up. Well, I guess that dude was friends with the real Josh. So he texts the real Josh, and he's like, yo, Josh, are you calling us, telling us about DEFCON? And he's like, no. And he's like, well, someone's calling, saying they're at this conference, DEFCON, and that we're going to get hacked. Well, 5 minutes later, the door opens up, and the real Josh comes walking in because he was 3 doors down at a speech. And the real Josh comes up to the table, and he goes, are you calling AT&T? And I'm like, no, not me, man, the guy in the booth. Because Because, like, him and his buddies were all, like, huge, you know? And they come walking in, like, it's fight time. And I'm like, yeah, not me, man. That guy in there, like, he should probably kick his butt. I'm just sitting by this computer watching this. His computer, too. You know, you could take it, you know? But, no, ended up, they weren't mad. They had this great picture. It was, like, such an awesome story, right, to have happen at DEF CON. You really can't make that stuff up. So after that year, you know, like I said, it was just a whole change in the tone for the conference and for the village, because people were now way more accepting of it, not viewing us as like some evil entity. So we moved on to DEF CON 21 and, you know, chose like who's the greatest, deadliest social engineer theme. Again, now what was awesome about this is the year before, I should have said this before, but DEF CON 18, 19, we had basically like one woman in both years compete. So to do the who's the, you know, battle of the sexes, I had to literally like cold call women in the community and talk them into joining the competition. And you know, we had a good number. We had 10 men and 10 women, and that worked out well. And then once that happened, the next year it was like tons and tons and tons of women. And you can just look around the room and see how awesome it is that there's probably more women in this room right now than there are men. And that is such a difference from when this village started, when it was all male dominated. And I think we have so many women winners now. It's like, I don't even know why guys even sign up anymore, you know? So the lesson that I learned from those years is, yeah, that women, they're going to scare us, you know, no matter what species we are. They're scary, man. They're scary. Yeah, that's the lessons that we can learn from those few years. So who's the deadliest social engineer? Well, at that point, we did something else really interesting. The year before, we had started our first kids competition. So the year before, I forgot to mention that, in DEF CON 20, we also said, let's expand this out to kids. And we had ages like 5 to 12, and we made ciphers and puzzles, and we handcuffed little kids to chairs, which I know in retrospect sounds so horrible, but it's DEF CON, right? And they had to like get their ways out, and they'd be crying. They'd be like, here's a shame, loser, get out, whatever. And it was just like, it was like really horrible, right? But they loved it. The kids kept coming back and begging for more. So this year I said, I have this amazing idea. Now, I got to tell you this story. And I realize when I tell you this, I'm like really stupid, okay? I get that. But this is what happened. I had this crazy idea in my head that we should do the last exercise of the whole kids competition where they have to solve a skiddly code. Now, if you don't know what that is, it's an ancient Roman code where they would take a piece of leather and wrap it around a wooden dowel, and they would carve their message on the leather. Then the leather would go with one messenger, the dowel with another. They would both go to the front lines, and if you didn't have the right dowel and the right leather, it didn't work. So we took a paper towel roll, we put paper around it, we wrote a Caesar cipher, then we shredded the paper. And then we put the shred in a bag, and the kids had to solve the shred. This was after like 8 hours of solving other ciphers. Like, we were really abusive. It was terrible. And then the code said that they had to run through the DEF CON SE Village room and insert the tube into a box in the back. So that was the idea I came up with. And I thought, how fun would it be if there was a sniper in the room with a Nerf gun shooting the kids as they ran through the room? So most of my ideas involve whiskey and late nights. So I tweet at like 1 a.m, any military grade snipers coming to DEF CON that want to shoot kids, DM me. Okay, now in retrospect, I understand that this is not the smartest of tweets for a person with two children to put out into the world. So I get a call from one of my buddies who works for a government agency and says, hey, Chris, I want to talk to you about your DEF CON idea. And I'm like, oh, it's awesome, man. Wait till I tell you about it. I got this great plan. And he's like, no, wait, before you tell me, can you just open up your Twitter account? And can you read that tweet out loud? And I'm like, yeah, sure, man, no problem. So I open it up and I go, oh, dear God in heaven, what have I done? I'm like, I have 3 DMs. He's like, can I have those names? I'm like, no, click. So we hired them. Okay. So We bought these Nerf CX60 long shot rifles, scopes, the whole nine yards. My son and I bought mod kits. We modded them. Then we practiced on my daughter, which I think is any good parent should do. I had her run through our yard, and we took turns shooting her. When they were strong enough to knock her over, we thought this is a great plan. Still not thinking, right? Okay. Then I take these Nerf guns, and I take them apart because they come apart in little cases. I put all of them into a duffel bag with four pairs of handcuffs, two pairs of duct tape, and I take it through TSA. So the TSA agent says, I gotta search your bag. I'm like, yeah, and I figured. And he unzips it, and he does this. And I just say, I'm going to Vegas. And he's like, okay. He zips it back up and hands it to me, right? I'm like, I guess that's an excuse for anything, you know? I'm glad, I'm really happy. My answer was, I'm going to shoot kids, right? So we did. I don't tell you, I'm taking tons of time on this story, but it's just great. So I got to tell you that way the kids won. So we had all these teams. The first kids, they've solved the cipher. They come running through the room, and Bones is over there on his sniper tower, and he's, and we just hear this kid fall, squeal, and I'm like, oh no. I'm like, at that moment in time is when I realized this was a horrible idea, because I'm hearing little children squeal in pain, and I'm like, oh no, this is such a bad idea. And I'm like, hey, Bones. You're like, you hired me, shut up. I'm like, oh God, what have I done? So these kids are running through, and the deal was whoever's holding the tube can't get shot, right? If you're holding the tube, you can't get shot. And we have teams of two kids. So this brother and sister team, the brother says to his sister, look, I'll be your human shield. So you hold the tube and I'll use my body and you won't get shot. To this day, it's like, oh my God. So he comes walking in real slow like this, and all you hear is, pff, ah, pff, ah, pff, ah, pff, ah. And I'm like, that's enough. He's like, he's not down. And I'm like, ah. And then he yells, clip. And there's another kid below him loading clips, throws a clip up. There's like, pff, ah, pff, ah. This kid is getting shot like 19 times. I'm like, no, you must stop. And the parents are in the corner, get him. And I'm like, what have we done? This does not leave them feeling better for having met you. So the kids finally get to the box. They shove the tube in and they turn around. Yes! And he goes, right in the forehead. I'm like, dude, they won. He's like, man down. So I take those guns. They're dismantled. I sold them on eBay. I don't want a memory of that. That's terrible. I'm like, no, no, man. We can't ever do that again. So that happened at DEF CON. Yeah, I'm still here, right? Okay. And something else cool happened that year. I was giving a speech with Apollo Robbins. And Will Smith was working on the movie Focus. And he came over and wanted to see the speech I was giving with Apollo. And then I got to hang out with him afterwards. It was really cool at DEF CON. Like, psh, right? So that was a really cool experience to have in SEVillage. I'm like, look at that. We just helped somebody like learn a skill for something that we're never going to do, like be in a movie. Okay. So DEF CON 22. This is when I said, I got to step the game up. Right? Let's see if we can make it more difficult for the people competing. So we can't. I laughed at this idea. Came up with the idea of a tag team. So you're going to sign up. I'm going to assign you a partner. You have no clue who they are. Somehow across the world or country, you're going to work together, and then you're going to get inside of a booth made for one person, both of you at the same time, and you have to figure out how to hand off the phone call. That was the concept, right, for it. So we did it. And I tell you, some of the pretext that they came up with, it was genius. One caller said, hey, listen, I'm working on training a new recruit. We're on Adobe Connect. That's why the number doesn't look very legit. And I want you to, I'm going to listen to him while he does the call, and then I'm going to grade him after that's done. Is that okay? And people were like, so willing. Yeah, sure, I'd love to help new employees. And then the second person would come on and be like, flag, 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 flag. And I'm like, this should not work. Like, why is it I can't make it hard for them? But it was quite amazing. So the first lesson was definitely, it didn't matter what we did. We still won, right? So that was like a huge learning lesson from DEF CON 22. We also then at that moment started Mission SE Impossible. It's much more advanced now, but this just started. This is also a really terrible idea. We handcuffed random people together and then threw a shim on the floor, and they had to figure out how to get out of the handcuffs. The ideas are not, I know, man, in retrospect, I think about it, it's not great. This is what it looked like in the booth with two people. Crazy, yeah. And this is what the room looked like. It was nuts, right? So we had, that's also the first year, DEF CON 22, when we started running speaking track. So we had people come in to fill time afterward, giving really great speeches to the crowd, right? So that was a really, really great year. Moving on to DEF CON 23, you could see, oh, that's DEF CON 22, the team. That's the team we ran the whole SEVillage with, right? Pretty small. So I was pretty proud of that moment that we can do all that we did with them. Okay. DEF CON 22 was this 22 or 23? Right, Chris Silvers, was that 22 or 23 for you? Where's Silvers?
I'm right here.
Oh. Yeah, but was that 23 or 24. You're 24? Okay. Man, I got the pictures messed up maybe, because I have a picture of you here, and I thought that was, maybe this is 24, and I just didn't, my slides are screwed up, I'm sorry. Yeah. Yeah, so that was you 24. So Chris Silvers won DEF CON 24 and still ends up working with us. The reason I'm bringing that up is because all these people that are still here, and we've abused them terribly in really weird ways, and they still stick around and are friends. I'm like, I know, it's great. I know. Yeah, and I feel the same way. It's quite an honor. So DEF CON 24, the room was expanded a little bit. We had more space than we ever did before in previous years. But again, it didn't help. We were still over capacity and full, and the great part was, as we would constantly ask people to tweet to DEF CON, give them a bigger room, give them a bigger room. And you guys would all comply, so DEF CON's Twitter account would get blown up, and then every year they would ask me, can you please stop asking the room to do that? And I'd be like, okay. And I'd be like, hey guys, I need you all to take your phones out and tweet to DEF CON, we need a bigger room. And they'd be like, can you please stop? And I'm like, no, because you told everyone we were closed this year, so take that, you know? Okay, and our DEF CON 25 team expanded a little bit. Our room got so big, we needed to expand our team. That really helped, right? DEF CON 26, just last year, Whitney took it home with a great win. If you didn't see that call, I believe Whitney and Chris Kirsch reenacted that call at Layer 8 conference, and it can be found on the internet. So I strongly suggest looking for those. Chris Kirsch, he won the year before, and him and I reenacted that call. I was the target, and he was the SE like he was on the call. And then last year, him and Whitney reenacted their call, and they're both out there. Really great videos to watch if you want to understand not only some pretexting ideas, but like the flow of the calls. Like we tried to reenact it as closely as possible with even confusion and things like that. Okay, so now that brings us up to, that brings us up to DEF CON 27 this year. Like, what the heck happened this year, right? I don't know yet. I didn't know when I was writing this, but I can tell you this year was crazy, right? I mean, so the first year we ever ran SECTF on Thursday. How was that for you guys? Did you like that? Yeah, it was good? Yeah? Yeah? Good. I'm happy with that because I liked it better too. We always have people saying Saturday was rough, trying to find support numbers that are open. So having it Thursday and Friday means that you're going to always get a weekday call. So I thought that was pretty cool that we can do that. So just an overview of what the themes were, right? So we look over the last decade of SECTF themes, and we can kind of see what it was that we started to do from the beginning. In addition, what I like about this is that we can start to see when we actually started choosing industry-related themes. So you can look at like DEF CON 23 is when we started seeing like telecommunications. And then after that, we just kept choosing themes: information security, gaming, transportation. And this year, let me clarify, it is not the ATF as in the government agency. It is alcohol, tobacco, and firearm industry. So people who manufacture those things that are Fortune 500s in this country. That was the theme for this year. Yeah, we don't call government, we don't call banks, and we don't call healthcare. And the reason is each one of those end in something very bad, right? So you're either getting arrested for calling government, you're breaking GLBA law for calling banks, or you're messing up on HIPAA for calling healthcare. None of those things are good for any of us, so there's no reason to do it and no reason to get close to that line, so we just don't. Okay, so let's talk about the SECTF winners. I wanted to figure out how we can make this applicable to us as a community, right? And what did SEVillage do over the last decade for us as a community? So before winning, I wanted to figure out, and I went through all the first and second place winners. So I didn't take every contestant. I just went through first and second place winners over the last 9 years. I don't have this year's statistics, right? So over the last 9 years, what did we see? Well, those that were in security or social engineering before they competed, 39% of contestants were involved in InfoSec before they competed in the SECTF. And 61% were not. Right? So we can see the difference there. Whereas after competition, what's happened? 72% decided to get into InfoSec and 28 non. Now, you can't do correlation, right, without real scientific study. So I can't sit here and say that it's definitely because of SEVillage that this has occurred. But I think it's a great stepping stone. And you can talk to people like Rachel, and you can talk to people like, I mean, Chris, you were in it before. you were doing this stuff. Yeah, but Hannah wasn't, right? So his daughter wasn't in it. And we can talk to people who've taken that leap after doing the competition and saying, wow, that was actually more fun and easier than I thought it would be. I want to try my hand at this. And we can see that huge statistical jump, 72% of people. So that helps me realize that this is a training ground. This is a beginning training ground. I shouldn't say it's an all-stop training ground, right? And why? Because here's some other learning lessons that I found in reviewing some of the stats, looking at SEVillage winners previous years. So I think they're pretty proud of the fact that they win or competed, because most people that have competed put it in their LinkedIn profile either as part of their resume or as in their honors section. You know, like saying, hey, I competed in the SECTF or I won. One of the big things we found is that time spent on reports generally average 60 plus hours that they spend on doing their OSINT and reports. And then the page count of winning reports generally over 50. So now we just can't sit here and say again correlation that quantity equals win. But what I can tell you from reading these reports for the last decade is that the reports that people spent 60 plus hours on, and the reports that came in with lots of detail and were filled with knowledge are the ones who people always got in that booth and they did excellent. And why? You know, what's the correlation there? Well, knowledge is power, right? And that is it is. So people get in that booth, they know the company so well. They're speaking the lingo. They're saying the acronyms. They're using the internal words. They're naming managers. We saw it today. People are getting asked, well, who's your manager? And some of the contestants are just spitting out names of actual employees that work there because they had known the company so well, they might know it better than their own company, right? They did that much OSINT on them. So we see this direct correlation to people who spend the time and energy actually become successful at competing in this competition. So what else does it tell us? Well, sadly, one of the other things that we learned is that companies are still pretty bad at this. Right? We still learn that because today, I got to say, I was really happy. We had a couple companies that really shut us down. I mean, shut us down bad. Now, I'm not talking if you were in the room. I'm not talking about the ones that don't answer their phone, because security through obscurity is not really security, right? So just hiding like an ostrich doesn't mean you're secure. But we talked, there was a few people that answered the phone today and asked legitimate questions, forced the caller into giving them details, you know, told, like really made them feel, who are you? Where do you work? Who's your manager? Showing that they had some training. They had some real critical thought. And I think that's amazing. That's wonderful to see. Also, I think when we look through the years, it's not always that 32% or whatever it is, those that were in the SE industry before or in InfoSec that won. Many times, the people who won don't do this at all. I think about Chris Kirsch, right? That guy's amazing. He was in marketing, right? He's still in marketing. But he got in there the first time he competed and completely bombed. And then he said, that's not the way I'm getting remembered. And he came back and he worked really hard and he got back in that booth and he owned it, right? And he doesn't do this for a living, and he still doesn't do it for a living. And yet, honestly, to me, his call is one of those, his group of calls are one of those calls that we can use as direct training. It was just phenomenal. So it doesn't take a pro to be successful. Another thing we learned, internal pretext work. You know what generally doesn't work? Actually, who can guess? What generally doesn't work? What pretext? Surveys. Someone said it. Every time we hear of surveys, especially external surveys, they generally don't work. Generally. Now, I can't say always, because there was one case with a guy who is standing in the back named Chris Silvers who won using a survey. He cheated a little. Actually, he didn't cheat. There was no cheating. He actually found out that they just did a survey. And he called and saying, yeah, your survey data didn't get sent. I need to redo it verbally. And then did it verbally. So I'm like, that's epic. You really can't fault that. So in that case, survey did win, but generally survey pretexts don't succeed in the SECTF because it's too easy to put off. But internals do. And then there's more, right? The big rule, which we've had and we said every year, leave them feeling better for having met you. You know, we've only had to disqualify one contestant in all 10 years. And for breaking this rule, only one. So out of 14 times 10, 140, and actually we used to have a couple more back in the day. We used to have like 10 each day. So we can even say probably more than 100, maybe 150, 160 competitors over a decade. Only one has got disqualified for breaking this rule. So that's great. That means that 139 people, 149 people successfully competed and won and never had to make someone feel bad, never had to cause fear, never had to threaten firing or getting hacked or breached. That's a pretty powerful statistic if you ask me, which means you can do it in this industry. You can actually be a professional and not have to be a malicious jerk. You can just play a bad guy on TV. You don't have to be one, right? Now, how? Why? Well, how is this possible? Well, you know, one of the things that came to me as I started to do this competition more and more, and I saw more and more people entering the industry, and I had people coming to me that were competing and then starting their own businesses and saying, how do you do that internally? How do you do that for your clients? How? And I kept asking this question, how? I realized that I had to do something to help those people who were asking. So we developed a code of conduct, code of ethics, I'm sorry, not a code of conduct, a code of ethics. I'm really proud of this code of ethics, to be honest, because it's gotten adopted by some major organizations and even a European country, if you can believe that. A European country called me. Isn't that weird to say that? A European country called me. I mean, obviously the country didn't call me, but someone called me from the government and said, we're developing a pen test rule book for all pen testers in our country. Could we use your code of ethics in that rule book? I'm like, heck yeah. That'd be great, right? So we put this out on the social-engineer.org site, make it publicly available for everyone to use internally, externally, however you want to use it. But for me, I'm really proud of this because it keeps that mantra throughout the whole theme of the code of ethics and how you can be a professional social engineer, but you don't have to be a bad person. You don't have to use fear. You don't have to use anger. You don't have to use extreme emotions to get the job done, and yet you could still leave room for education, which is our second mantra, right? But why? Why did I feel the need to have to go this far to actually create a code of ethics? And to me, the simple answer is looking at something like this Google trend, right? Look at that left side bar. This is from 2009 when I did my very first SECTF. Now, this has nothing to do with the SECTF. I was using the years. And then you jump forward to this year, right? Or was it 2018? Last year. And look at the difference in the interest in social engineering over those years. We can see the interest in social engineering has gone up. People are searching for it. They're talking about it. They're discussing it. Back 2009, social engineering wasn't a very hot topic. It was in our community, but it wasn't in the corporate world and the business community. And now what we can see just by watching trends is that it's more searchable. People are looking for it more. They want to know more about it. And I think probably the most common question that we get in our company is, how do I get into this industry? The second most common question is, how do I hack Facebook? But that is the first most common question, is how do I get into this industry? As a matter of fact, this second day of DEF CON, I've been asked that question more than 6 times a day by different people in this room. How do I get into this industry? So we had to write a code of ethics, because people want to be in this industry and feel that it's necessary to start there. But we also have a series of blog posts and podcasts and newsletters that can help you with how to break in, how to break into this industry. Other trends we noticed. Okay. I'm running out of time. I didn't leave much time for questions, but I'm going to rant for a second. So the other trends that we notice is that, sadly, this in our industry, the I always need to be 100% motto still exists. And it's not great. I mean, think about that. Don't think about yourself as a pen tester for a second. Think about yourself as a client. And now someone comes to you and says, you're always going to lose. You're never going to win. Give me more money. Right? Now, I'm not suggesting that we let them win. I don't think that's a good idea. But I am suggesting that we need to work on improving our methodology and how we train to help them win. So it's a legitimate win. Right? And if we can't do that, then why are we in this business? Is it just about our own egos so we can feel good hacking people? That's not the right motto, right? Second, bad mouthing competition to get work. You know what I found? This statistic, that this is a graph that shows how many U.S. companies are actually actively doing phishing training. 15% are actually doing phishing training in the U.S. And there is more than enough work for all of us. We don't have to beat each other up. We can be competitors, and we can actually be friendly. We can help each other. We don't have to be jerks about it. We don't have to walk around DEF CON bad-mouthing each other, talking bad about who does what and this and that. We don't walk around other communities doing that. We can actually band together, become stronger, and fix the problem, or try to at least. I don't know if we'll ever fix it, but we could try to. Right? There's more than enough work for that. Okay. I got 8 minutes, so I'm going to try to push this rant through, because this is my big one. This is my pet peeve, okay? And a pet peeve is live tweeting. Live tweeting. Now, I don't mean live tweeting of everything. I mean live tweeting your pen tests. Live tweeting the things you're doing for your clients. How stinking awful is it? Again, don't think about it in yourself. How are you if you're a client and you're sitting there and you know you hired me, and now you see one of my tweets go, man, this company is like Swiss cheese. Man, this company's a wet paper bag. I didn't mention your name, but I say that. And you know that I'm talking about you. How does that make you feel? Have I left you better for having met me? No, it doesn't. It's terrible. So I asked 3 or 4 people that I truly respect in the industry that do pen testing, red teaming. I asked them just plain out. I didn't tell them what it was for until they answered me. I said, can you tell me what you think about this topic of live tweeting pen tests? And I don't know why I put Dave as first, because he spent his whole life pranking me. But Dave, and this is, you know, Dave made a really good point. His customers are looking to them. They're trusting them for trusted special services. And live tweeting these things hurt customer relations, right? He ends it with, it's not the right thing to do. And that's a valid point. Chris Nickerson, I look up to him for years before I actually started my own company. You know, the things that he does. The red team, you haven't heard him, Layers, I talked to him about this, and he said it's a breach of contract to do these things. Pretty strong language, right? I talked to Wayne, my buddy who did the first SECTF call, and same thing. I mean, just look at this, it's wrong and really just stupid and selfish. Man, powerful words, right? And then finally, Chris Roberts, you might know him. He's the guy who supposedly made a plane slide sideways. No, just kidding. And he talked about how it's not professional. It's not professional. Again, clients are looking at us for confidential work, trust, and ethical work. So when you do these things, it really breaks that trust down and that confidence down. And it's just not great. It's just not great as a professional. Okay? I'm going to end the rant with live tweet makes Hulk mad. Okay. Don't do it. Okay? It does. So end of rant. Done. Let's talk about takeaway facts as we finish this up and maybe have enough time for a couple questions. So the competition was born where? at a hacker convention. Okay, so at the biggest hacker convention with the most volatile network on the planet Earth, that's where the competition was born, but with a goal to show how social engineering was dangerous and it was still a very viable vector. But if we can change, it can change your life for the better if you allow it. And we've seen that happen so many times for people who've competed and won, or people who just competed. I've had people come in and tell me, man, they've had job offers after competing and being in the booth, been interviewed in major articles, and that's changed their life for the better. If we can actually use the experience to learn and grow, which is a big, big thing, which means coming together as a community, working together, and not fighting against each other. And then we can really leave each other better for having met each other, right? And still grow in this industry and band together. The funny part is the bad guys do it. They kind of band together. They share secrets on their forums. They tell each other how they do things. So there's no reason for us not to do the same exact thing. And then shameless plug time is that kind of moved all of this SEVillage, not moved it, we're still here, we're going to be here, but we decided to start our own conference, our social engineering conference, to really talk about how social engineering can become a professional profession. Is that a right sentence? Professional profession? I used the word profession twice in a row. Okay, I'm going to do it. A professional profession, and how you can grow in this industry and become a professional social engineer. Okay, those are the lessons I got. Folks, I have a few minutes for questions. I can try to answer if you have any. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, sir. Yes, you back. Yes, the nice shirt.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So I'm sorry, I missed most of your talk.
I can't redo it. I only have 3 minutes.
But when is SECTF and how do I sign up?
So SECTF for this year is over. You sign up by watching the social-engineer.org site. Sometime in January is when we will announce 2020's SECTF, assuming we are invited back by DEF CON. So if we are, we will announce it then. Yes, sir. Wayne Ronaldson, sir. No problem. Debate date of birth. No, I'm just kidding.
I'd like to say that I think that we all in this room here are very fortunate that Chris started doing this, because for me, when I've been trying to sell social engineering to a client that needs it, because of these competitions, they were much easier to sign that dotted line and accept it, because they started to understand what the true value of it really was. So I think that's a big round of applause to Chris and his team.
Thanks, man. That wasn't a question. I'll give you the $50 later. You and Rachel, man. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
So I've been tasked with doing some of this internally, and other than DEF CON and the Florida Conference, are there local organizations? Do you have local offshoots, or information that my company's free to send me?
I don't have any local organizations, but I know that there's some really good B-sides in certain areas, and ISSAs, which could be really good. You really have to just check about what kind of content they provide. Not all of them are going to be applicable for you. I know a lot of people use on the social-engineer.org site, we have a framework for social engineering, and I actually know of a few very large companies that use that framework to plan out all of their services for the year that they want to have. So you can look on that, and it's just all free information. You know, we try to put out as much as possible, the blogs, newsletters, podcasts, the framework, and it's all free. So you can use that as part of your security awareness, and I'll give you a card, and we can talk more after. Yeah, that'd be great. So, yes, sir. So the question was, the person that got disqualified, what did he or she do? He called as the president of a company, and when she stopped complying because she got nervous, he threatened to have her fired. Right? So now think about this. We don't know her life circumstance. So she's sitting at home. She hasn't paid her mortgage in 2 months. Her car bill's late. She just got divorced. Her husband's screwing her, ex-husband's screwing her over. And now you just say you're going to get fired. How do we know how that affects her? Right? Maybe she does something awful to herself. Maybe she, you know, I don't want to paint a morbid picture. We just don't know how that affects somebody. I don't want to ever have that on my conscience, that a competition, a game, created an environment where someone could harm themselves or someone else. So that to me is like automatic DQ. Yeah, I don't mess with that. You're done. We cut his call. We shut the phone down, said, out, you're over. Yeah, just I have no time for that. Yeah. Let's see. Yes, sir.
Hey, Chris.
Dan.
Ten years, great job.
Thank you.
What's the biggest impasse that you've seen in your career and the best way to get over? For all the individuals that are here getting into social engineering, or are only doing it for a short period of time?
Wow. Holy mackerel. Can I have another hour?
Yes.
No. Yeah, no, I can't. That would definitely not leave people feeling better for having met me. Okay, so you know, quickly, and I can maybe answer this after out in the hallway for those who want to ask more questions, but I think the biggest impasse for me was getting corporate America to understand that social engineering is a viable and real vector, that you need to have services surrounding, and that there's no blinky box you can put into your network that fixes the human. So for me, and it's not saying I'm not going to say I fixed that, because I didn't. I think what happened is the fact that we see that Google trend, the more people talking about SE meant the more times that corporate America was hearing it, the more times phishing stories were in the news, the more times that corporate America was thinking about it. And that's how I got past that, was by just what Wayne said, was using those things, using this competition, all as a basis to say that's why we need to do this. So I think, you know, Wayne kind of hit it on the head that I've been doing the same thing. You know, yes. I can't say. First of all, I'm not going to say yes or no to anything, because I'm not going to tell you what the theme is for next year. We'll see. Maybe. Maybe. I have 14 seconds. Ha ha, the time has stopped. We made time stand still. Questions for 14 seconds. I'm just kidding. Okay, I'm over time. So guys, if you want, I'll go out in the hallway. We can talk a little more if anyone has more questions. And thank you so much for a great 10 years.